The Pope just said what he believes is the cause of the coronavirus. Watch this.
Puede que sea todo esto un ajuste de cuentas de la naturaleza con nosotros.
Hay un dicho que seguramente vos lo conocés. Dios perdona siempre. Nosotros perdonamos de vez en cuando. La naturaleza no perdona nunca. Los incendios, las inundaciones, los terremotos. O sea, la naturaleza está pataleando para que nos hagamos cargo del cuidado de la naturaleza.
Now we know what the Pope believes is the cause of the coronavirus, and it has everything to do with what I believe is going to be the Pope's big October surprise. Now, maybe that date will change. We don't know. We will see. But we know this. In the crosshairs of the Pope's focus and agenda is this big event scheduled, slated for October. This is what I'm going to focus on in this video. You don't want to miss this. If you want to understand things in a prophetic context, you need to watch this entire video. Okay, to the screen, everybody. This is coming in October. Big event. I believe it has prophetic overtones. But first, I want to get into your hands this special book, Mark of the Beast. Free book. Click on the link below and you'll get a copy of this book, an ebook. And if you would like, you can give a donation. A donation is appreciated but not required. Just fill out the information. You'll also be able to receive prophecy alerts from us. And be sure also and subscribe to our YouTube channel and hit the bell icon so you don't miss any of our future uploads. All right, let's continue, everybody. So it's coming in October. Number one, the Pope is saying the cause of the coronavirus is how we have been mistreating nature, the environment. As we go to broadcast right now, there are over 113,000 infected here in the United States of America of the coronavirus, almost 2,000 deaths and climbing. Indeed, the National Catholic Register, Pope Francis sends a message of hope amid coronavirus pandemic. I have hope in the peoples, that is the nations of the world, who are going to take lessons from this crisis to reevaluate, rethink their lives. In other words, think through what changes they need to make. We're going to come out better. Pope Francis also said that with a crisis like this, nature's giving us a jolt to take charge of taking care of nature. Rep part, Pope Francis, coronavirus pandemic is nature throwing a tantrum, according to the Pope. The pontiff suggested that nature is calling for attention. There is a saying, the Pope says, which you have heard, God always forgives. We sometimes forgive, nature never forgives, Pope Francis said. Fires, earthquakes, nature is throwing a tantrum so that we will take care of her. A true ecological approach, always a social approach. Keep that in mind, everybody. I know where I'm going. Always a social approach becomes. The Pope wrote in his 2015 encyclical, the landmark encyclical letter, Laudato Si, in care of our common home. So Pope Francis is saying essentially that it's time, high time, critical time for major changes in our lifestyle here in America and abroad. And he makes it very clear that his Laudato Si is a good framework in which these changes can take place. Furthermore, we know that Francis issues urgent call with plans for fifth anniversary of Laudato Si, which is May 2020. And I have a video clip that gets into this right now. You got to watch it. It's a short little video clip, but you need to watch this. You don't want to get off of this video. You need to watch this whole video. Stay tuned. Let's keep going, everybody. Okay, here it is.
¿Qué tipo de mundo queremos dejar a quienes nos sucedan, a los niños que están creciendo? Motivado por esta pregunta, quisiera invitarlos a participar en la Semana Laudato Si, del 16 al 24 de mayo del 2020. Es una campaña global en ocasión del quinto aniversario de la Carta Encíclica Laudato Si sobre el cuidado de la casa común. Renuevo mi llamado urgente a responder la crisis ecológica. El clamor de la tierra y el clamor de los pobres no dan para más. Cuidemos la creación, don de nuestro buen Dios Creador. Celebremos juntos la Semana Laudato Si. Que Dios los bendiga. Y no se olviden de rezar por mí.
Slated for May 2020. And in terms of how they continue with this celebration and encouraging everybody to be involved in this celebration of Laudato Si remains to be seen, depending on how this crisis of the coronavirus pans out. But to the screen, I renew my urgent call to respond to the ecological crisis, the Pope continues. And come on, everybody, the coronavirus gives the Pope a stronger voice. Who can deny that? The cry of the earth and the cry of the poor cannot continue. Let's take care of creation, a gift of our good Creator God. Let's celebrate Laudato Si week together. Now look here, everybody, look here. I believe that as Christians, we must be good stewards of planet Earth. We should not just trash this earth. We should not just destroy this earth and think that somehow God doesn't care. God does care. But I do believe that we need to be careful to keep our eyes on Jesus. We need to keep our eyes on what God's Word says. We need to keep our eyes on end time Bible prophecies. And so let's continue. Back to the screen. Okay, we keep going. So the Pope wants us to hear the cry of the earth and to follow his Laudato Si on care for our common home. You say, well, Mark, what's so bad about Laudato Si? Well, first of all, I believe that there's a lot of good in it. But what's interesting is that according to Crux, Pope considering adding sin against ecology to church's catechism. In other words, the Pope is saying we need to start incorporating into the Roman Catholic Catechism ecological sins. And so very interesting indeed. So number two, who else is saying that the coronavirus is caused in a large part by how mankind has been mistreating nature and the environment? Well, World Health Organization. Humans have known, and I'm not downplaying World Health Organization. This is not some deep, conspiracy theory. This is just plain truth in plain sight from the Bible and current events. So, but it's a fact. Humans have known that climate conditions affect epidemic diseases from long before the role of infectious agents was discovered, all right? Here is an example of how diverse environmental changes affect the occurrence of various infectious diseases in humans. I don't have time to go through that. You'll be able to rewind and play on the uploaded video, but you need to take note of this chart. Very fascinating indeed. And so the Times of Israel article, a virus is expected to increase with global warming. Population growth, loss of natural habitats, likely to bring wild animals into more contact with humans, easing way for infectious diseases to jump between species. Viruses can be expected to increase with global warming as humans and wild animals are forced into closer contact. Many emerging infectious diseases are the result of animal-human contact. AIDS originated with chimpanzees and Ebola is suspected to have come from Africa fruit bats. Researchers, watch this, found that nearly 75% of all new emerging or re-emerging diseases affecting humans at the beginning of the 21st century are zoonotic. Very fascinating indeed. The World Health Organization has warned categorically that climate change, along with other demographic, social, and technological changes, will affect infectious disease occurrence. Now, in the Environmental Health News article, Coronavirus, Climate Change, and the Environment, this is a director of Harvard's University Center of Climate Health and Global Environment. People who breathe dirtier air, like there in China, for example, were twice as likely to die from the infection. And the air in New York City, not too good. In Los Angeles, not too good. Climate change has already made conditions more favorable to the spread of some infectious diseases. All right, so here you have it. Number one, mankind's lifestyle leads to climate change, many would say. Many would say the science is there. Some would say, no, the science is not there. There's a lot of debate on this issue, but mankind's lifestyle equals climate change equals pestilences and disease. I think the research is there, which equals death, which equals emergency, a climate emergency, as we're being told. Number three, the Pope is saying, let Christians and Catholics, Protestants and Catholics, unite in prayer for the coronavirus. Well, hey, I'm praying about God to be with us all during this time. The Christian Post article, Pope calls for global reciting of Lord's Prayer Wednesday, ecumenical bodies pledge to participate. Catholic Herald, Pope Francis leads Catholics in worldwide, notice the word, ecumenical Lord's Prayer against coronavirus. Now, I agree, whether you're Catholic or Protestant, we should all pray for the coronavirus, that God will have mercy on planet Earth. Yes, we must all unite, regardless of denominational affiliation. But here's what the Pope is really seeking for. Telegraph Herald, Pope Francis seeking to unite Christianity. And he's looking at this crisis as being a catalyst for this uniting of Christianity, uniting Protestants and Catholics, reuniting everyone together. It sounds good. Now, NPR, Pope Francis delivers special prayer for end to coronavirus pandemic. And he did this just last night as he spoke to an empty St. Peter's Square. You must watch this. Very short portion of video clip I have for you right now.
Pope Francis led this extraordinary moment of prayer amid the coronavirus pandemic, with the faithful participating online from the safety of their homes. The Vatican was empty like never before during his pontificate. The reading from the Gospel of Mark, chosen specifically for this occasion, recounts the story of Jesus calming the seas. In his homily, the Pope compared the tempest from the Gospel to the current pandemic, which has uprooted the daily routines of people around the world.
In questo nostro mondo, che tu ami più di noi, siamo andati avanti a tutta velocità, sentendoci forti e capaci di tutto.
Okay, everybody, so we continue. So look here, everybody, this is very, very significant. The Catholic Church, the Roman Catholic Church, and by the way, I believe that God has his true faithful followers in all different denominations or no denomination. I do believe that if you're Catholic, there are many Catholics I believe will be in heaven. Many Protestants will be in heaven. There'll be some Catholics not in heaven. There'll be some Protestants not in heaven. What I believe is if it's in the Bible, we want it. If it's not in the Bible, we don't want it. So whether you're Roman Catholic, whether you're Protestant, let's go to the Word of God. And as you learn the Word of God, God will lead you to make different changes in your life. God does that every day of our life. Now watch this. The Roman Church is all about imagery. The Roman Church is all about ceremonies and rituals and so forth, because images are powerful and reminders and can be etched in our minds. And so here you have this imagery of Pope Francis speaking to an empty St. Peter's Square, as if that doesn't make an impression. Because very soon, that place is going to be packed. And the Pope, I believe, is most likely going to have a stronger voice than ever about the climate change, because I repeat, he believes that climate change is the catalyst. The climate change is the framework in which this coronavirus has taken place. We need to continue. You don't want to miss this. This is timely, relevant content that I'm giving you right now. And I hope you will share it with many of your friends. So, very interesting article here in Crux. A united humanity will rise from pandemic-stricken world, Pope says. And I say, yes, let human beings, let mankind unite more. I say a hearty amen. But let me tell you something, if that means uniting over doing something that our conscience says no and God's word condemns, then we have to choose, are we going to go along with the majority or with the word of God? So let's unite where we can, okay? But let's make sure that we don't compromise with the word from straying from the word of God. Yes, unity is what you're going to hear more and more about, because this coronavirus is an equalizer. Right? This is an equalizer, because regardless of your denominational label, regardless of your ethnicity or how smart you are, or how much money you have, it doesn't matter. This virus goes after anybody and everybody. And so we're united, it's true, in our suffering. We're united in our common enemy, this, like President Trump says, this invisible enemy. But you must be careful about a false unity as well. Because this Pope has made it very, very clear, as have previous popes, that the protest, Protestant, the root word in Protestant is protest, the protest is over. So what he's saying is, let's forget the past. Forget those dark ages. Forget that the Catholic Church is responsible for the death of 50 million people. Now, I repeat, must we be loving to one another? Absolutely. Must we be forgiving? Yes. But should we just forget history? Absolutely not. Because history and prophecy, they go together. Our world is changing. Our world is changing at a pace that has never been seen in history. Indeed, we know, number four, the coronavirus is changing everything. That's right, everything. And right now, nearly a third, according to CNN, nearly a third of the world's population are living under the coronavirus-related movement, with related movement restrictions. So this is just rocking our planet. Coronavirus has infected 199 countries. We're hearing about coronavirus lockdown. Millions and millions of Americans, over 100 million, actually, are in lockdown. Matter of fact, according to a poll, Americans want a national lockdown. Bill Gates is calling for a national lockdown. And I'll be doing another video about Bill Gates and how he predicted this and other things that he is promoting. I believe he's doing some good, but we need to look at everything. Everyone is hearing the urgent message repeatedly to stay home. And can you say family time? Hey, a lot of good can come out of this. New York City is under attack. It is under siege of this invisible enemy called the coronavirus. And right now, today's news, President Trump, according to Fox News, mulls coronavirus quarantine on New York, New Jersey, Connecticut. All right? So New York City at this moment is the epicenter of this deadly virus, and its hospitals are about to be absolutely overwhelmed. And we see restaurants closed. We see subways closed. We see streets deserted. Oh yes, it's very, very surreal. You're gonna look back and say, did we really live through that? A pandemic has hit America, everybody. It is here. And worst case scenario, there can be, I pray there's not, and if I had to guess, I'd say there's not going to be this, but worst case scenario, there can be 2.2 million Americans who will die from the coronavirus. I repeat, I don't believe that's going to happen, but that is a worst case scenario. We must be wise enough to observe the trends, movements, conditions, and developments in the world today. And we must know what news to pay attention to. Now watch this, everybody. I've come here tonight to say some things. A, the coronavirus is changing everything. Are you going to argue with that? B, everything is connected. Have you read Bible prophecy lately? C, everything is leading up to something big, something prophetic. It's leading up to things that are happening this year, next year. We don't know how much time we have. We don't know the day or the hour in which the Lord will come. We don't know when the tribulation will commence. We don't know when the seven last plagues are going to be poured out, but they're coming. Number five, Pope is summoning world leaders and influencers, world leaders and educational authorities to sign a global, to come to the Vatican, come to Rome, to sign a global educational pact, an educational alliance pact in October, was going to be in May. But could this be that because the coronavirus changed the date, led the Vatican, led Pope Francis to be forced into changing it from May to another date? Could it be that the very fact that the coronavirus has happened that moved this big event? Could it be that this event will be bigger than it would have been in May because of the coronavirus? Indeed, Pope to launch global educational pact next year. That was announced in September 2019. And then I did a video right now. My video is trending about May 14, 2020. Well, this is a follow-up video to that. That one has about 560,000 views. And so I know there's a lot of interest as that video has gone viral. And so this is relevant, everybody. This is timely. This is, look here, everybody. I'm passionate about this. This is so urgent. This video, not because of me, I'm a small man with a big message. This video needs to go around the world. Millions and millions of people need to see this video. Why? Because I'm here to tell you, ladies and gentlemen, I'm here to tell you, just as surely as I know I'm breathing, that everything is connected. I don't mean in a hocus-pocus weird way. I'm not talking about being superstitious. I'm not talking about being sensational. I'm just talking about, come on now, look at what's going on with the coronavirus. Look at what the Word of God tells us. It will be events like we're going through right now that will lead to the mark of the beast. I don't know when the mark of the beast is going to be enforced. You don't know when that's going to happen either. But we know it's these kind of events that will lead to a rapid succession of monumental prophetic biblical events and developments. You have to stay close to our channel because we're going to be giving you, we're on this, we're all over this, these stories. You need to let your friends know that Amazing Prophecies, Mark Fox channel here, we're on this, we're all over this, we're gonna stay, we're not gonna be diverted from preaching Jesus Christ, his end time prophecies, and what's going on in the world today that relates to these biblical prophecies. All right, let's keep going, everybody. You don't want to miss the rest of this. Don't miss this. Okay, so here we go. So I want you to watch a little bit of this video that the Pope sent out in which he invites everyone, the influencers, whether it's sports stars or celebrities or whoever, to come to the Vatican. And now it's going to be in October. I just have a little portion I want to play for you right now.
Per questo desidero incontrarvi a Roma per promuovere insieme ed attivare questo patto educativo. Insieme a voi faccio appello a tutte le personalità pubbliche che a livello mondiale sono già impegnate nel delicato settore dell'educazione delle nuove generazioni. ho fiducia che non si tireranno indietro. Cerchiamo insieme di trovare soluzioni, avviare i processi di trasformazione, senza paura. Invito ciascuno di voi ad essere protagonista di questa alleanza. L'appuntamento è per il giorno 14 maggio 2020 a Roma. Vi aspetto e fin d'ora vi saluto e benedico. Grazie.
Okay, everybody, to the screen. Vatican News. Global compact, notice, compact and agreement on education. All right, hold on just a second, everybody. Technical thing here. Okay, global compact on education event moved to October. So this is very, very significant. This is all about, hey, let's re-educate everybody about the environment, about our moral responsibility. So world leaders come to the Vatican to sign global pact. That is what the Vatican is focused on. So the Pope is once again calling for unity, a solidarity among the nations like never before, and he believes that the key is an education alliance. The Pope is very clear that he wants to educate the world according to his encyclical on the environment and promoting our common home. In other words, the Pope wants to educate you. Well, I believe some of that is going to be probably spot on, probably based on good science, some of it and so forth. But the timing of the big event was changed because of the coronavirus. And will this big event, therefore, become bigger as a result of the coronavirus? That's my point. This is what drove me to get this, spend hours getting this broadcast together. Will the Pope continue to use climate change to promote his authority and status in world affairs? I believe he will. Is he seeking for world dominance of the papacy? I believe he is. Is the Pope using the coronavirus as a golden opportunity to stoke fears that mankind has angered Mother Earth? Yes. Well, obviously he's doing a personification of the Earth. I don't subscribe to that. This is the Earth, okay? But the point is, is the Earth groaning in travail, as it were? The Bible makes it very clear. Is mankind doing some things to the Earth that is causing the Earth to have a lot of disorientation and destruction and so forth? Yes, yes, absolutely. So what will be the primary curriculum in this education alliance? I'll give you a moment to think. All right, your time is up. There's no guesswork here. Pope Francis, speaking at the United Nations in 2015, right here in the United States, there in New York City, what did he promote? Laudato Si. You see, wherever he goes and whoever he talks to, he promotes his Laudato Si. At the Educational Alliance in 2020, he's going to be promoting it. U.S. Congress in 2015, when he spoke to the United States Congress, he promoted Laudato Si. That never happened before. No, Pope never speaking there at United States Congress. Paris Summit promoted Laudato Si. United Nations video message in 2019, there May 24. And on the anniversary, I believe it was, of the Laudato Si. Amazon Synod 2019. President Trump, what did he hand President Trump when Trump visited him at the Vatican? Handed him a copy of Laudato Si. The climate change strikes were to help celebrate Laudato Si. You want proof? Well, here's precious young Greta Thunberg. And by the way, I would say this, that I praise the Lord that young people care about the Earth. I think that's a good thing. We should care about this Earth. But shouldn't we care about our Creator even more than the Earth? Shouldn't we care about Jesus more than anything? Nonetheless, I commend her for her interest in doing something good, and that is to help planet Earth. You might disagree with some of her methods or whatever, but I think we should pray for these young people and pray that, hey, look, if you were these young people, wouldn't you want the adults to take care of the earth a little bit better. And so, I mean, I understand that. But notice the sign that she held up to Pope Francis. Join the climate strike. Celebrate, I hope you can see that, celebrate Laudato Si on May 24. That's the anniversary. Can't you see that the climate strikes that have swept around the world, and Greta Thunberg being the spokesman and the number one person in the limelight? I mean, she's become a voice for the climate strikes. And indeed, what is she saying? Hey, celebrate Laudato Si. So here you see that the Pope is asserting himself in the climate change conversation. Both Greta Thunberg and Pope Francis spoke about climate change to the United Nations on May 24, 2019. The Pope did it by a video message, and Greta Thunberg in person. And I have done videos on this topic and some of our most popular videos, because many who have some discernment understand that these are big issues. This is no trivial pursuit. And there you see a little snapshot of my some of my videos. Anyway, I hope you will go to my channel and subscribe, Amazing Prophecies. And the video that is viral right now is Breaking Pope Prophecy, Red Alert. So you can check those out. Okay, number six, the Pope includes a false Sabbath. A false Sabbath as part of his Laudato Si, as part of the solution to the environmental crisis. Watch this short video clip of an interview on 60 Minutes in which he made it very clear at the core, one of the core pieces of his Laudato Si is this.
Se vive con el acelerador puesto desde la mañana hasta la noche. Y eso arruina la salud mental, la salud espiritual y la salud física. Más aún, arruina y destruye la familia y por lo tanto la sociedad. El séptimo día descansó. Lo que los judíos tenían y tienen, ¿no es cierto?, los observantes, como sagrado cumplir el Shabbat. El sábado se descansa un día a la semana, al menos eso, para la gratuidad, para dar culto a Dios, para estar con la familia, para jugar, para hacer todas esas cosas. No somos máquinas.
Okay, everybody, so look at the screen. Sunday, this is in Laudato Si, Sunday like the Jewish Sabbath. Notice he's calling the Sabbath the Jewish Sabbath. There's nothing in the Bible that teaches that the Sabbath is only for the Jews. It's for everybody. It was given to Adam and Eve. Sunday like the Jewish Sabbath is meant to be a day which heals our relationships with God, with ourselves, with others, and with the world. It, referring to Sunday, protects human action from becoming empty activism. It, Sunday, also prevents that unfettered greed and sense of isolation which makes us seek personal gain to the detriment of all else. The law of weekly rest forbade work on the seventh day, Exodus 23:12. Rest opens our eyes to the larger picture and gives us renewed sensitivity to the rights of others. Now the Pope makes it very clear, the Vatican's position. The Roman Catholic Church teaches that part of the rights of others is a right to have a Sunday law. That's part of what they believe, is that workers' rights include having Sunday off, and this should become a law, a national Sunday law. And so the day of rest, centered on Eucharist, sheds its light on the whole week and motivates us to greater concern for nature and the poor. So what is he saying? Sunday rest will actually motivate people to take care of the environment and nature better, because it's a moral issue anyway. So what is he saying? We need to have Sunday laws, because that will help people to be more concerned for the nature, the environment, and the poor. So, Pope Francis is here promoting a false Sabbath, a counterfeit Sabbath. Number 7, the Roman Catholic Church admits they changed the Sabbath from Saturday to Sunday. Almost the whole Christian world reverences Sunday. Now, I can go to church on Sunday. I can go to church 7 days a week. But there's only one day that is the Sabbath, and that's the seventh day of the week. Almost the whole Christian world reverences Sunday. Did God know that this attempt to change His holy Sabbath would occur? Daniel 7:25. He, speaking about the Catholic Church, shall speak great words against the Most High, shall wear out the saints of the Most High, and think to change times and laws. What's the only commandment, or the only law, that has to do with time that the Roman Church would change? It's the seventh day Sabbath, the only one that has to do with time. God said, remember, this is God. This is God speaking. This isn't man. This isn't a denominational theory. This is the Ten Commandments. Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is the Sabbath, not of the Jew. No, no, no. The seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord your God. It's the Lord's day. In it you shall do no work, you nor your son, nor your daughter, nor your male servant, nor your female servant, nor your cattle, nor your stranger who is within your gates. For in 6 days the Lord made the heavens and the earth, the sea and all that is in them, and rested the seventh day. Therefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and hallowed it. I urge you, you need to get this book, Mark of the Beast, because I cannot cover all of this in this broadcast. Get this free book. Click on the link below. Fill out the information. You'll also be able to get prophecy alerts from us and more. And so all you need to do is click on the link. And so donation is appreciated, but not required. But if you can stand with us, we need your help. God is helping us to reach the world. Everybody's being told, stay home. Many are coming to our channel and learning the truth. We need your help. If you can stand with us, we need you, as we are a self-supporting ministry, nonprofit. And so please go there and donate as you are able. And you'll see also other ways you can donate in the description below. We continue. And so on my channel, I cover these various topics. And so the Roman Catholic Church frankly admits changing the biblical Sabbath, the seventh day of the week, to Sunday, the first day of the week. Here's the catechism. Here's a catechism. Look what I have in my hands, everybody. Look what I have in my hands, okay? Look here. I have here the latest Roman Catholic catechism, okay? And in a little bit of an older version, the Converts Catechism, 1977 version, but it basically teaches the same thing as well. You can check these things out. Go to the screen. Question, this is Catholic position. Which is the Sabbath day? Answer, Saturday is the Sabbath day. Question, why do we observe Sunday instead of Saturday? Answer, we observe Sunday instead of Saturday because the Catholic Church transferred the solemnity from Saturday to Sunday. Bombshell admission. Wow. Another Catholic quote. Of course, the Catholic Church claims that the change, that is from Saturday to Sunday, was her act. And the act is a mark of her power, a mark of her ecclesiastical power. That's what they claim. They claim Sunday is a mark of their power because they claim that God gave them authority to change the Ten Commandments. Mark of her ecclesiastical power and authority in religious matters. And in an encyclical called Dies Domini, Pope John Paul II said, in this matter, my predecessor, Pope Leo XIII, in his encyclical Rerum, spoke of Sunday rest as a worker's right which the state must guarantee. What would you call that? Sunday laws. So what is John Paul II talking about? He's talking about we need Sunday laws. And you remember that John Paul was from Poland. What do we know about Poland? Poland was promoting labor unions. And of course, we know that Sunday rest is front and center in all of this conversation. Now, the center of Catholic education is the Catechism. And in the Catechism, it says, in respecting religious liberty and the common good of all, that's a term the Catholic Church loves to use, the word common. Common good of all, Christians should seek recognition of Sundays and the Church's holy days as legal holidays. Common good, Sundays, legal holidays. What would you call that? Sunday laws. They have to give everyone a public example of prayer, respect, and joy, and defend their traditions as a precious contribution to the spiritual life of society. If a country's legislation or other reasons require work on Sunday, the day should nevertheless be lived as the day of our deliverance, which lets us share in this festal gathering, this assembly of the firstborn who are enrolled in heaven. So the Pope includes a wrong solution for the climate solution, namely Sunday rest. So Sunday rest to be enforced eventually one day, because it's good for the individual, good for the family, good for society, good for the environment. It's a common day for the common good of all. Number eight, the final test before Jesus comes is over. The issue of God's true seventh-day Sabbath, according to the Ten Commandments, versus the man-made tradition of Sunday. That's the issue. Man's day or God's day? Man's changed commandments or God's unchanged commandments? Remember, God's special number that he uses is the number seven. Jesus warned, for false Christs and false prophets will rise and show great signs and wonders to deceive, if possible, even the elect. See, I've told you beforehand, Matthew 24:24. Paul said, speaking about the papacy, let no one deceive you by any means. For that day, the coming of Jesus, second coming of Christ, will not come unless the falling away comes first. And the man of sin, the papacy, is revealed, the son of perdition, who opposes and exalts himself above all that is called God or that is worshiped, so that he sits as God in the temple of God, the Christian community, showing himself that he is God, acting like he's God, but he's not. 2 Thessalonians 2:3-4. Saying, oh, don't worry, Protestants, the protest is over. No, it's not. And I saw one of his heads as if it had been mortally wounded. His deadly wound was sealed, and all the world marveled and followed the Roman papal beast. All who dwell on the earth will worship him, whose names have not been written in the book of life of the Lamb slain from the foundation of the world. The issue is worship, Revelation 13:8. That's why, in the word of God, then a third angel followed them, saying with a loud voice, if anyone worships the beast and his image and receives his mark on his forehead or on his hand, he himself shall also drink of the wine of the wrath of God, which is poured out full strength into the cup of his indignation. He shall be tormented with fire and brimstone in the presence of the holy angels and in the presence of the Lamb, and the smoke of their torment ascends forever and ever, and they have no rest day nor night, who worship the beast and his image, and whoever receives the mark of his name. Notice, worshiping the beast, you get the mark of the beast. Worship the image of the beast, you get the mark of the beast. You need that book. You need to read that book. Then I saw another angel flying in the midst of heaven, having the everlasting gospel to preach to those who dwell in the earth. Man, do I want to be part of a church that's preaching these messages to every nation, tribe, tongue, and people, saying with a loud voice, fear God and give glory to him. The hour of his judgment is come, and worship him who made heaven and earth, the sea and the springs of waters. What would you call worship him who made? Worship your creator. Don't worship the earth. Worship him who made the earth. And who's going to be preaching these messages around the world? A global movement, a global remnant, preaching Jesus Christ, preaching the cross of Calvary, the two C words, the cross and the commandments. Here is the patience of the saints. I want to be among that number, don't you? Here are those who keep the commandments of God, including the seventh-day Sabbath, and the faith of Jesus Christ, Revelation 14:12. Oh, the Bible makes it very clear at the very beginning. Thus the heavens and the earth and all the hosts of them were finished, and on the seventh day God ended his work which he had done, and he rested on the seventh day from all his work which he had done. Then God blessed the seventh day and sanctified it, because in it he rested from all his work which God had created and made. Oh, my friends, We are living in the last moments of Earth's history. We need to go back to basics. We need to go back to basics. Go back to the seventh day. Yes, Jesus said, the Sabbath was made for man, and not man for the Sabbath. Therefore, the Son of Man is also Lord of the Sabbath. He's Lord of the Sabbath. If he's Lord of your life, then you want to keep the Sabbath because he's Lord of the Sabbath. It's the Lord's day. What did Jesus do on the Sabbath? He went to church. So he came to Nazareth where he'd been brought up. And as his custom was, he went into the synagogue on the Sabbath day and stood up to read. And by the way, as I'm giving this broadcast, as I'm recording this, it's the Sabbath. Luke 4:16. I was in the Spirit on the Lord's day. Don't tell me there's no difference. That any day, you can just pick any day. No, I was in the Spirit on the Lord's day. Don't misinterpret Scripture. And I heard behind me a loud voice as of a trumpet. For whoever shall keep the whole law, and yet stumble in one point, he is guilty of all. If you're breaking the Sabbath, you're breaking them all. If you love me, keep my commandments, Jesus said. Even Paul said, do we then make void the law through faith? Certainly not. On the contrary, we establish the law. But the devil doesn't want you to keep the Sabbath. But you can keep the Sabbath. The dragon was enraged with the woman, that's the church, and he went to make war with the remnant, with the rest of offspring who keep the commandments of God. I want to be part of that seventh day keeping people, don't you? Keep the commandments of God and have the testimony of Jesus Christ. Oh, my friends, blessed are those who do his commandments, that they may have the right to the tree of life and may enter through the gates of the city. Where is that found? Last book, last chapter, Revelation 20:14. Friends, as I close, we cannot keep up with all the news, and so therefore you and I must have a spiritual, biblical discernment to know what news to pay attention to. You and I must know what to pay attention to. Pope calls for global reciting of the Lord's Prayer. Well, it sounds good, but what if he says, let's all come together and keep Sunday? President Trump declares national emergency, and rightly so. And then President Trump calls for a National Day of Prayer. Declaration has deep American roots. Well, my friends, what if the emergency becomes greater? And then Protestants unite with Catholics. And Protestants and evangelicals who influence President Trump say, hey, we don't need just a National Day of Prayer. We need a national Sunday law so that nobody has to work on that day, so that people can go to church on that day. Besides, Trump wants packed churches and economy open again on Easter Sunday, despite the deadly threat of coronavirus. Now, most likely that's not going to happen. But my point is, the evangelicals would love this. President Trump would love this. The Roman papal power would love what? For everybody to keep Sunday. Can I go to church on Sunday? Yes. Can I go to church 7 days a week? Yes. But my friends, the primary day should be the seventh day of the week. That's the only day that is the Bible Sabbath. Oh, yes. And the climate change movement, it's clear that as people are staying more at home, there's less pollution. Oh, could it be that they're going to say, you know, if everybody would just rest on Sunday, it could help the environment and it would also help you to keep Sunday holy. I don't know how it's all going to pan out. Should we be praying right now? Like never before. Oh, my friends, the enemy wants to catch you and I by surprise. He doesn't want you to understand these things that you're hearing in this broadcast. I'm here to tell you, we must not be distracted or deceived, but rather to be enlightened and encouraged by a serious study of God's Word and His end-time Bible prophecies that are relevant today. Have you given your heart to Jesus Christ? Once again, click on the link below and get this book and share it with others. Stand with us. Help us get this message out. Stand with us. There's a phone number you can call. You can give over the phone. You can just stand with us. Help us to get this message out. Or you can send a check to Forever Free Ministries, P.O. Box 785, Lake Dallas, Texas, 75065. Oh, yes. You can also text Bible to 74121. and you get a free online Bible study course link. Text Bible to 74121. You can also get a link to a Bible Prophecy Church near you. And also, as I close, I want to encourage you to go and subscribe to another channel, Bible Prophecy Made Clear. My good friend Jared Bowling has a channel there, Bible Prophecy Made Clear. Go and subscribe and you'll be blessed. And so, look here, everybody, I'm here to tell you, we got to close. I want to close with prayer, short prayer. I love you in the name of Jesus. Give your heart to Jesus. I invite you right now below to say, Jesus, I will follow you. You need to know who you're following. Jesus, I will follow you. Go ahead and type below. Jesus, I will follow you. Some of you have heard this Sabbath teaching for the first time. Some of you have heard it before. I invite you to type below. Jesus, help me to keep your Sabbath. Jesus, help me to keep your Sabbath. And we have a handout that we can get to you. 50 things to do on the Sabbath. Just email us. That's all you need to do. AmazingProphecies@gmail.com. AmazingProphecies@gmail.com. And you can get 50 things to do on the Sabbath. And we can also help you find a church that keeps the seventh day holy. Let's pray. Father in heaven, bless all of us to stay close to Jesus. Is my prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you. Until next time, this is Mark Fox signing off for now. Remember, Jesus loves you.